Hello everyone. In this first of two videos for this week, I'm going to be discussing Othello Act 5, Scenes 1 and 2, or at least portions of Scene 2. This video will be a little bit shorter than some of the other ones that I've produced. The next video is going to focus on an extensive close reading of Act 5, Scene 2, and the culmination of Iago's plot to diminish and destroy Othello, to destroy everything that he loves, and to strip him of his humanity. And we'll discuss the ways in which Shakespeare's overarching narrative for the character overcomes Iago's machinations. His story is the one that's playing out in this play, not Iago's. Act 5, Scene 1 begins with one of the explicit moments of metatheatricality, wherein Iago is performing the role of director or playwright. He is indicating to Rodrigo where he should stand. He is literally setting context, setting the stage for the grand act of his art. He has primed all the actors. He's given them their lines. He's influenced and corrupted their minds to the point that they're speaking his language. They're thinking his thoughts. He's married himself to them. He has orchestrated all the events that have led up to this point, and he is staging this last scene of the play. So Act 5, Scene 1 begins with Iago positioning his actors. Here, stand behind this box. Straight away will he will come. Wear thy good raper here and put it home. Quick, quick, fear nothing. So he's telling him, here's what your action should be. Remember that make sure that your costume is in proper place. Stand in this location and then carry out the plot that I have orchestrated. So again, we have this notion of Iago as the director of events. Iago, as an aside, then reveals something about his motivations in perhaps the most honest revelation that he offers us in the course of the play. He speaks about his plot to destroy Cassio. And now his reason for destroying Cassio is not simply that he wants revenge against him because Cassio assumed the lieutenantship that Iago desired, but instead, if Cassio do remain, he says in line 18, he hath a daily beauty in his life that makes me ugly. So Iago reveals to us this terrifying jealousy. There's this beauty to him, there's this nobility to him that I see and I must destroy because it's something that I lack. You remember that I compared Iago to the Joker in the Christopher Nolan Batman movies. Well, some men just want to watch the world burn. Some men are so filled with anger, hatred, and spite that they are rankled by the joy and the beauty that they see in others and want nothing more than to destroy it. That, too, is a characteristic of the devil that Iago represents. Iago executes his plot. He eventually kills Rodrigo. Rodrigo has been injured in the fight with Cassio. Cassio has been crippled. As he's crying for help, Iago emerges and pretends to be shocked by this injury that Cassio has suffered, this heinous assault that he has been subjected to in the middle of the night. They're found by a group of other soldiers. Iago leans into Rodrigo, who is gasping his last breaths, and then Iago stabs him and murders him as he is laying on the ground, unbeknownst to the other assembled soldiers, because they're hidden by the dark. And as he stabs Rodrigo in line 63, Iago says, "Oh villain," he stabs Rodrigo. "Rodrigo, oh damned Iago, oh inhuman dog." And Rodrigo groans and dies. What we have here is a signal of Iago's coming reduction. What he has attempted to do to all the other characters is what Rodrigo, ironically enough, is going to do to Iago. "Oh inhuman dog." Iago is going to be stripped of his defining human characteristics, those things that have made him so potent throughout the rest of the play, largely because of Rodrigo. He doesn't know it now, but Iago has, because he has had a gap or a blind spot in his perception of events, sealed his own destruction by betraying Rodrigo. And he too is going to be reduced to the status of voiceless object that he has attempted to reduce all the other characters to. Othello overhears Cassio's screams and believes that Iago has carried out his part of their murder pact. The scene that follows in Act 5, Scene 2 is steeped in erotic violence as Othello murders his wife on essentially their wedding sheets, on their marital bed. And it's explicitly couched in that fashion. Because as he looks upon her, pondering what he's going to do, trying to work himself up or work up the courage necessary to murder his wife in her bed, courage, he speaks of her beauty and her matchless quality. "I'll not shed her blood nor scar that whiter skin of hers than snow and smooth as monumental alabaster." Yet she must die, else she'll betray more men. Put out the light, and then put out the light. So he has to cause the entire scene to descend into darkness. He looks over at the candle beside the bed and says, put it out, put out the light, and then put out the light of her life and the light of his life, as he subsumes himself in darkness. And Shakespeare is playing with these racialized connotations as he embraces, or as Othello embraces, this monstrous and savage act. Shakespeare is couching this in the racial stereotypes of his age. Is he doing this, however, I would caution you, to embrace those stereotypes or to do the opposite of Iago? Is he planning through this apparent knife's edge of embracing these stereotypes, actually intending to overturn them and destroy them, to return Othello to the kind of nobility that upset or upended the racial stereotype at the beginning of the play? I would argue that he is, and we'll see how Shakespeare approaches the racial question and tries to grapple with it and to overturn those stereotypes as we move into the end of Act 5. But at this moment, he's on the edge of embracing the stereotype that Iago has attempted to reduce him to, the black savage. Again, that's Iago's intention. Is it Shakespeare's? I would argue no, but we'll come to that as we move on into the next video. Now, there's a moment of commingled humor and horror as Othello murders Desdemona, and then Emilia comes in looking for her mistress. Desdemona croaks out in line 123, "A guiltless death I die." And Emilia looks upon her fallen mistress and says, "Oh, who hath done this deed?" Desdemona, "No, but I myself, farewell. Commend me to my kind lord, oh, farewell," and she dies. Now, Othello looks on this scene, and he's so guilt-ridden, so embroiled in chaos, as he says, "When I love her not, chaos has come again." He's so emotionally distraught that he points to the corpse. And he says, "You heard her. You heard her say herself, it was not I." And Emilia says, "Oh, she said so. I must needs report the truth. She's like a liar gone to burning hell. 'Twas I that killed her." His grief and the chaos of his mind is just too much for him, and he resorts to this further accusation against Desdemona. "Oh, the more angel she, and you the blacker devil." Eventually, the other characters enter into the scene, and Emilia, because of Othello's revelations in his emotional state, realizes what Iago has done, realizes that it was his machinations that set Othello on the path of supposed revenge against his wife for the perceived slights and dishonor that she has brought to him. Now, at this moment, Iago is reduced to shouting and stamping his feet. All of his vaunted control, his masterful ability to direct events, has been undone by the most unlikely of individuals, the person that he believed he had the most control over, the person who said earlier in this play, "I nothing, I do nothing, and I am nothing, but something to please his fancies," Emilia, his wife. He believed that he had cowed her, that he had constrained her sufficiently to ensure that she would never speak out against him. But here, Emilia sees this injustice. She takes up her voice to do exactly what she said she would do in Act 4, when she said, "Let our husbands know the ills that we do, their ills instruct us so. I will repay, I will revenge myself against the one who has done me wrong." And so she follows through with this declaration, just as Desdemona did the same when she said, "Let those ills that they have done to me teach me how to be more empathetic, to be more sympathetic, and to be more forgiving." Both women here fulfill their prophecies in the previous act. Desdemona forgives her husband and speaks out in defense of him. Emilia does the exact opposite and condemns justly her husband. She speaks, she regains her voice. Iago orders her in line 216, "Swoons, hold your peace." Emilia, "I will out, I will out. I peace? No, I will speak as liberal as the North. Let heaven and men and devils, let them all cry shame against me. Yet I'll speak." Language fails Iago. He's reduced to physical violence. The tools, the wit that he has used throughout this play are now of no value to him. All he has is brute, animal, physical violence in the face of his wife, whose words now stand ready to condemn him. There's a kind of anti-parallelism, a kind of chiasmic structure to this play. In Act 1, Desdemona's words redeemed Othello. Here, Amelia destroys her husband, justly. And she says, whether it is any power in this world or beyond, heaven, God, devils, or men, regardless, nothing will prevent me from speaking. No imposed authority structure will prevent me from speaking out against this injustice, because I now have a duty to a higher power, justice itself. That is the thing to which I owe my allegiance, and nothing in this world is going to stop me from actually carrying out that duty. And, in fact, a duty to the wronged mistress who has been murdered. I will speak out. She reveals what has transpired, condemning Iago before the assembled men. Now, Othello learns the truth, and he has this horrible moment of recognition that he has murdered an innocent woman and destroyed all that he loves, both in public and in private life. But Othello seems to find a degree of peace with this. In line 243, he says, I am not valiant neither, but every puny whipster gets my sword. But why should honor outlive honesty? Let it all go. I'm done. Everything that I was, my honor, which was everything that he was, his identity, his life, it's gone. Why should I continue? Let it all go. Life is already over. Amelia, what did thy song bode, lady? Hark, canst thou hear me? I will play the swan and die in music. And she takes up that willow's song that connected them to past generations, thinking back to that one shining moment of unity that they had. Moor, she was chaste. She loved thee, cruel Moor. So come my soul to bliss as I speak true. So speaking as I think, alas, I die. So there's a strange, almost reversal of expectations in this moment. As she is killed and we reach the culmination of this tragic narrative, she also finds her voice. She achieves this one last shining moment of victory, but this moment of victory comes at the cost of her life. Now what we see here with the fraught conclusion to Amelia's narrative, we will see again with Othello as we continue Act 5 in the next video. You expect that to be posted later on this week.